Greetings, family of overcomers. Welcome to the house of overcomers, where God is developing overcomers for victorious living. And today, you are one of them. We welcome you. I'm Pastor Lee Bynum, and this is New Hope Community Fellowship. Let me say to our listeners and to our viewers, I thank you today for tuning in. I thank you for what you do. Thank the family of overcomers for your giving. Thank those who are viewing us throughout the country in Florida, Michigan, New York, Ohio, Arizona. We thank you for you tuning in and here in the Carolinas. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Well, let's go to Word and pray. God, we thank you today. And Father, bless us now with your word. We're going to receive this word that our lives will be blessed as we move to another revelation of grace in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Meet me in the book of Hebrews this morning, the fourth chapter. Meet me in the book of Hebrews this morning, the fourth chapter, verses 15 and 16. Hebrews 4, 15 and 16. This is our fourth installment of the Grace series, and the last installment for us, this series is concerned, and it was the grace that kept me. Fourth chapter, verse 15. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let's go to work. It was the grace that kept me. Church family, people of God, overcomers, if we have learned anything over the past few weeks, is the fact that we are here by the marvelous grace of God. The amazing thing about God's grace is that when you know God for yourself, you begin to realize what you really have in Him. It's clear that before, with all of the challenges that we have experienced in this season, that God has given to you a level of adaptability, a level of productivity, and on the level of sustainability that is wrapped up in the grace of God, that you've been able to make some adjustments to adapt to the things you would have never imagined. Look at you. You've made some adjustments. In the midst of all those adjustments, you've been adapting, yet you're produced even in the middle of all the negativity around you. You're still producing. You're still creating. And in the midst of all of that, you've been sustained in the fact that you're still here. Not by accident, nor is it something to be taken lightly. It is something to give God glory for in and of itself. You see, people of God, after we've been through all we've been through, we agree with the psalmist who declared emphatically in Psalms 124 when he said, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, let Israel say, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us alive. When their wrath was kindled against us, then the waters would have overwhelmed us. The stream would have gone over our soul. Then the swollen waters would have gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord, who has not given us as prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I'm sharing this teaching today because God needs you to understand that you are kept by the grace of God. The impact of the crises that are happening around you and the circumstances that are inevitably have been falling you, they pale in comparison to the powerful and marvelous grace of God that is working on you. There are people who are going down your timeline trying to figure out how you're surviving, how you're still winning, how you're still making it after taking all that you can take. However, they have grossly underestimated who you are. They have not factored in the fact that God's grace has been on your life, and that God's grace is yet continuing in and through your life, and you are yet fighting, and it does not mean you don't have weak moments. It does not mean that you don't have moments when you feel like giving up, but you're still fighting, you're still thriving. Why? Because you can testify today that it was grace, the grace of God, that kept you. I want to help you to understand something. Today, as we look at this word in the book of Hebrews, and it's a word about identification in Christ. It's a word that helps us understand who Jesus is in our life. And when you understand that, you have to have an awareness that my Savior sympathizes with my struggle. Let me say that again. When you understand that, you have to have an awareness that my Savior sympathizes with my struggle. Paul reminds us that what's important is you have to know who God is in your life. We have a high priest, he says, who understands and sympathizes with our plight because he came in the world, and because of that, we have the assurance that he automatically knows what we're dealing with. In John chapter 1, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word became flesh. And the Bible said, we beheld his glory. Jesus was God, divinity, yet he was human at the same time. So the duality afforded him to give the opportunity to identify with us in the natural, and therefore our frustration and our challenges and our pains he feels. He is in the natural, dealt with them as well. As a matter of fact, what it indicates to us is that he's never too high that he can't meet you in your low. Let me say that again. You missed that. He's never too high that he can't meet you in your low. In the Old Testament, among the Hebrew people, there were two schools of thought. These two thoughts dealt with one of the transcendence of God, which referred to the reverence of how God was uniquely positioned above the people. When Moses went up to the mountain to get the Ten Commandments, Elijah fights the battle against the prophets of Baal. Up there, the psalmist declares, I will look to the hill from which come my help, because my help comes from the Lord. You see? Then the other school of thought is the aspect of God's presence. That is God's imminence. That suggests that God is actively down here in our affairs of our lives, helping us to navigate interesting terrain, to the point that David says, I was in the valley of the shadow of death. I looked around and found out thou art with me. There it is. And so the idea here is that we should have a healthy understanding of this aspect of God, that he is not so common among us that we lose the reverence of God and that we lose honor of God. We become too familiar with God, but yet God is not so far away that we feel like God can't fear what we're going to. He can't feel what we're going through. Now, as a matter of fact, Isaiah 59:1 says it this way. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, nor his ear heavy that it cannot hear. So what you have to understand as a child of God is that it doesn't matter how low you might find yourself. It doesn't matter how emotionally or spiritually you find yourself low. God is not so high that God cannot meet you where you are. Unlike worldly priests, our people sometimes, we have such a disconnect to what we're dealing with. But the good news is, whatever you're going through, God knows all about it. And God will get right down there with you, and he'll help you in some of the most tough times, in some of the tightest spaces. And here's the deal. He is the template on how to handle trouble. He's the template on how to handle trouble. You missed that. He's the template. He's the example. If you need an example of how to handle the moment that you're going through, Jesus Christ became a template. Every experience that we experience, now it's really played out in the life of Jesus Christ. He shows us how to handle every situation that becomes an example or a model of whatever you're dealing with. He's already experienced it. That's why he says, in this life, you're going to have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I've already overcome it. He's giving you these things to comfort you. Because whatever you're dealing with, you have to know that he's already dealt with it. Oh, you missed it. Whatever you're experiencing, he's already experienced. And left it on record how to handle it. You missed that. He left it on record how to handle it. He left it on record as how to handle it. These are teachable moments. Think about it. You get criticism. Jesus says, let me show you how to handle criticism. Matthew 5:11 said, blessed are those when they say all men of evil are against you. Jesus deals with criticism, and he teaches us about that when you deal with judgmental people. In John chapter 8, when the woman was caught in adultery, Jesus looked around and said, I tell you, this is how you deal with judgmental people. He said, he looked at him and he said, you without sin cast the first stone. When Jesus was dealing with temptation, Jesus said in Matthew 4, you're not the only one that's been tempted. I've been tempted, but I counter temptation with the word of God. I told Satan, it is written. You're dealing with rejection? Luke chapter 4, verse 24, Jesus said, listen to the prophet. He is without honor except in his own country. But guess what? God will use your rejection for redirection, because the very stone that was rejected became the chief cornerstone. Y'all don't hear me this morning. You got stones in your life? Jesus says, I'll show you how to deal with them. I'll show you how to deal with storms. Jesus was asleep in the middle of a storm in Mark 4, which says that if your faith is awake, you can go to sleep. You missed that. If your faith is awake, then you can go to sleep. You dealing with betrayal? Luke 22:48. You got a Judas among you? How do you deal with people who are trying to backstab you? Jesus said, keep them close long enough. Keep your enemies close long enough so that you can always understand that God will always protect the plan that he has over your life. Then if you got a cross, you got a cross over your life, you feel like you're being crucified, Jesus said, I'll tell you how to handle it. Just hang in there. Woo, God. When they lie on you, hang in there. When they stab you in the back, hang in there. When they talk about you, hang in there. You see, he becomes an example of how to deal with what you're dealing with. We have a high priest who sympathizes. But wait a minute. That's why I approach his throne with the right posture. I approach his throne with the right posture. When I come to him, I don't go to him broken, tore down. I don't go go to him despondent, but I go boldly to the throne of grace. Let me talk about it. Let me help you remember this. Your boldness is greater than your brokenness. That makes sense? That makes sense? Your boldness is greater than your brokenness. Can you say that? Can you say that with me? My boldness is greater than my brokenness. Say it again. My boldness is greater than my brokenness. See, we experience things in our life, and we must make sure that our crisis is never greater than our confidence. You missed that. Listen. What we have in Jesus Christ, family, causes us to rise up and move beyond being timid and come to a place that we approach with confidence. We have to go boldly. I know things are tough right now. I know they may be rough in your life, but you got to come boldly with confidence. And you got to know that when you come, you must come with an expectancy. Woo! Don't just come. Come with expectancy. We don't just come out of form and fashion. I'm not just praying to be going to God just to be going through the motion. No, let me tell you that I've learned that Hebrews 11:6 says that without faith, it's impossible to please him. Those who go to God must believe that he is, and he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And that's why when I go to him, somebody's watching me right now. And you know when you go to God, you're expecting God to do something. You're expecting God something to happen between the time you go down on your knees and the time you get up. You're expecting God to turn your situation around. You're expecting a miracle. You're expecting a healing. You're expecting a turnaround. You're expecting doors to be opened. You're expecting God to cover you when you go to God to pray. See, you got to learn how to start giving God glory. For what you're expecting God to do. And listen. When I have people that set the stage for my life, I go boldly to the throne. But wait a minute. I must accept my need for mercy. Paul said, we come to the throne that we might receive mercy. Let's be real here. We haven't dotted every I, and we haven't crossed every T in this season. Some of us have done some stuff, and we still like, Lord, I find myself sometimes having good days. I find myself sometimes having bad days. I'm having ups, I'm having downs, and I don't always do all the things I should do. But in the midst of all these things and all these trying times, I'm being exhausted, I'm frustrated, I'm aggravated. What I've come to understand is don't be in denial about your weakness. Woo! Too many times we are weak, but we don't want to be truthful about being weak. See, I can't be in denial about my weakness when I go to God, because God already knows I'm weak. See, I got to stop pretending that I've got everything together. Everything is just flowing just right. See, when I go to God, I've got to go with a need. Lord, I'm broken, and I'm in a place in my life, but I come boldly, and I come transparent. God, I need your mercy. Family, you've got to understand something. God is not looking for perfection. You missed that. God is not looking for perfection. God is looking for truth. He's not looking for perfect people. He's looking for truthful people. Paul said that mercy is available at the throne of grace, at the throne of God. See, some of us don't have an appreciation for God's mercy. Let me unpack this. When you really understand that you haven't done all you should have done, you understand that you're not ever worthy to be where you are in him. See, Christ prevents the penalty. Now, see, the consequence is that my wrongdoing had a certain outcome. But when he steps in, Mercy prevents the consequences. Mercy prevented the penalty from being enforced. Now, let me tell you, you ought to be giving God glory right now. Because it's not that you were innocent. It just means God's mercy stepped in. It means that God's mercy blocked it. Oh, I believe I got a witness for that when you look back over your life, you can testify that you're not here because you're perfect. You're here because of His mercy. His mercy endures through all generations. See, every time you go on your job, you ought to say mercy. Every time you put food in your mouth, you ought to say mercy. Every time you inhale and exhale, you ought to say mercy. Because when you understand the power of the mercy of God, let me prove something to you. Here it is. You need to acknowledge where your help comes from. See, I'm here to help somebody. Family, people of God, this last point is so powerful. Because when you come to the throne and we expect to find grace and help in a time of need. See, the grace that keeps us, ooh, God, I thank you, it's in direct proportion to the realization and revelation of how His power works in our lives. When you know where your help comes from, you don't have to depend upon people. You missed that. We put people in situations they were never ordained to be put in. We've been counting on people to do things for us, but if COVID-19 should have taught us that now more than ever before, you can't depend on people per se. You have got to depend totally and completely on God. What I've learned about God, He's an on-time God. My God, that we might find help in the time. Paul says, listen, that God shows up and it's in His time. I need Him where He gives me. He understands God's time is not like your time and my time. God can be late and still be early. God can show up and you wonder, Lord, what's taking so long? Like when He showed up at Bethany and He showed up at Lazarus' house and Mary and Martha were upset with Jesus and Jesus said, show me where they laid Him. Because it does not matter what time is on your clock. He shows up when He shows up and it's already His time to do what He needs to do. Somebody can be a witness. That's why Big Mama used to say, she said, He may not come when you want Him. But He's always on time. God moves in such a way that He's, the psalmist said, He's a present help in a time of trouble. Oh, I'm giving God the praise because I need somebody to know right now that God's going to move right now. That all you need God to do, so you can testify that He's an on time God. When you didn't know how He was going to pay the bill, you was going to pay the bill. And right before they were about to evict you, He's an on time God. Let me tell you something. That's why in this season, like never before, I remain in pursuit of His presence and His promise. In these uncertain times, I remain in pursuit of His presence and His promise. The grace has been keeping you. You're not like the stuff. Now people have learned to reassess their lives and they begin to reassess what's important. And now we begin to realize what's essential. And now I'm not chasing stuff. I'm not chasing people. But Lord, I realize where my help comes from. And I realize what's been keeping me. And as a result, this is a season for God. This is a season for God chasers. This is a season for people who have survived. This is a season for people who've come through. This is a season for people who have overcome. And now you're at the point of your life, you're just like, Lord, I want to thank You that You kept me. You know something? We shout about a whole lot of stuff. We shout about our cars. We shout about our house. We shout about our jobs. We shout about our boo, our honey boo boo. But I need you to just, you ought to just take 2 minutes, God, I thank you. 2 minutes out of your day right now. Right while you're watching me. And you ought to just give God glory. That God has been a keeper. Keeper of you. Give God glory. That he kept your mind. Give God glory. That he kept your marriage. Give God glory. That he kept your family. Give God glory that he kept your children. God kept your money. God kept your health. You ought to thank God that he's a keeper. Because when all the other stuff fades away, God, I want to thank you, God, because I will still be standing. Woo! Because I am a child of a king. And I'm giving him the glory. Because in him I live. In him I move. In him I have my being. You see, it was grace, not my money. It was grace, not my friends. It was grace, not my education. It was grace, not my family. It was grace that kept me. And it's the grace of God that will keep you. Let me talk to you this morning. You're watching this and you say, Pastor, you're preaching down my street. And all you need to understand about the simple message is important to understand that we all need to understand something, that God has given us a certain level of adaptability, sustainability, productivity, and he's kept us when we look back over this season. I want you to come out of this. And we're going to come out of this. You're going to look back over coronavirus and mock this day. You're going to look back over the season and somebody's going to ask you, what were you thankful for? And you're going to say, I'm thankful for so much, but I can sum it all up in this. God kept me. And God kept you for a reason. God never forgot about you. I don't care how low you are right now. I don't care how bad your situation is right now. He knows your name. He connected you to this message today. And God is speaking to you because he cares about you. And what I want you to do, if you need a relationship with him today, if you want to give your life back to him, God, I thank you. I want you to receive it. See, right now, he cares about you. Lift your hands and receive this declaration right now. I want to declare it over your life. He knows your name. He knows it. He knows it. He knows a child of God. Hallelujah. He knows your name. Doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter who's written you off. It doesn't matter how much you've lost. It doesn't matter how much trauma, how much tragedy, how much stress, how much mess. He still says, hi, God, I thank you. And he looks low. He will come down and get your situation. He will get in your situation. He will get in your mess. He will get in your stress. And it won't be by accident. Do you know that God's grace? It says he sympathizes with you. Look at this. He walks with you. He will even give you the words you need today. He will talk with you. And he will tell you, God, thank you. is alone. You know how good God has been to you? Oh my God. He woke you up this morning. You got blood running in your veins. You got a roof over your head. Whew, glory to God. Let me leave you with this. Here's a testimony. All the things you've been through, that you've been through with God, you matter. And the grace of God that covers you, beloved. Ooh, glory to God. That keeps you is the grace that preserves you. Until that which He places in you comes to fruition is God's grace. Thank you, Lord. That kept you. And it's that grace, that will make you great. He knows your name. He knows you, child of God. You're not tuned in today by accident. It's God's promise for you today that you should hear this and that you should invite Him into your life to receive Him as Savior and as Lord. And God knows, woo, that the grace that produced you is the grace to handle it, is the grace that saved you, and it's the grace that will keep you. I want you to receive that. Oh, in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. If you receive that, I want you to email me, pastor@newhope-c.org. He knows your name. Family, mission, love you, hold on, faith, hope, much love. Tune in next week. God bless you.